forget about that one. I'll put the link up to at Blackboard, which we're not going to be able to show you anything from Blackboard then. So, with the birthmark, as I commented, we had an allegorical understanding that this is a story to symbolize the struggle man has and the dual nature, if you will, that man has himself, of body and soul, of matter and spirit. That's very clearly drawn throughout the story, where you constantly have those references. If you go through the story and look at how often references are made to spirit, to soul, to physical matter, clay, the idea of, I mean, references appear frequently in that way. The body, at one time, of course, Georgiana has fainted, right? And she's called a lifeless form. You have a death-like trance that she comes out of. These concepts of life and death, of matter and soul, or matter and spirit, of clay and spirit also, science and nature, all these contrasts are built into the story to emphasize that man has that continual struggle, the desire to perpetuate, but the forced recognition that existence is finite. It really comes through in the story with that flower that Georgiana observes and that Almer demonstrates for her. He puts a seed, and in moments, up comes a shoot, and then a perfect and lovely flower, quote from the story. And Georgiana's response is, it's magic. Nothing can grow that fast, and I dare not touch it. Now, does she dare not touch it because she finds it too perfect and lovely, too beautiful? Or does she dare not touch it because of its magic? And there's a concern, a worry, a fear. Well, that's not specified. Almer urges her, nay, pluck it, he says. Pluck it, breathe in its aroma, its scent. Tell it, because soon it's going to wither. It's going to wither and die, leaving behind only brown seeds, which we'll have to plant, and the word as user, to perpetuate. He says, we'll be perpetuated again, and those new blossoms, once you plant the seed and they spring up, they will be as ephemeral, get a word from the story, as ephemeral as the original. That nothing's going to last. That this thing which is perfect and lovely will not last, because the perfect is not part of this realm. Go again through the story and you'll see how often perfect and imperfection are used. Every time you go through the story, especially in regard to Georgiana and the beauty mark, the birthmark, whichever one you want to call it, there's going to be some reference about imperfection. It is a sign for imperfection. It is a sign to, and a reminder to Almer that Georgiana is subject to sin, sorrow, decay, and death. She will not last. Just as in that symbolic moment in the story later, when the seed is planted, the little flower bursts forth immediately, becoming perfect and lovely, but knowing that it will die shortly. That is symbolic. That's called foreshadowing. You see that? Almer knows it's going to die. He admits it. It'll wither soon. He knows. He's created something perfect and lovely, but it's only ephemeral. It's not lasting. Cannot. His whole goal, to make the birthmark disappear so that Georgiana will be perfect and lovely. And Hawthorne gives you that moment in the story to foreshadow that once the birthmark is gone, once Almer achieves his aim, Georgiana will not last long. She will die. We already know right there. It's called foreshadowing, seeing things up in advance. As you go through A Rose for Emily, the contrast is also part of it. This idea of what once was and what now is. The inevitability, as says in the birthmark that live, death is inevitable. You cannot forestall it. If you're a part of this world, that is inevitable. With a Rose for Emily, Faulkner drives home the point that change is inevitable. That the old ways will pass. That what has been will die away to be replaced by something new. And that is emphasized early in the story. Look at the first line. Again, in the textbook, that's 778. It says, when Miss Emily Grierson died. There you are. Death. Acknowledgement. Now, background on Faulkner, which you were supposed to see with the video, but we couldn't get the machine to work. Now it's going to work because I just saw the thing come up. With the details of Faulkner, he is, as I said to you just a moment ago, off of the recording, from Oxford, Mississippi, grew up there. You'll all be pleased to know that you can achieve success and you can be well recognized and you can do really well writing and never finish high school because he quit during his junior year. His father was not necessarily happy about it, but said, okay, so go get a job, which he did not. He took a couple of part-time jobs, really didn't do too much, but about the time that he was leaning toward the World War I had broken out, the United States was not involved in it, and he wanted to go and fight, so he went up to Canada to join the Royal Canadian Air Force. So Canada was involved since they were part of the British Commonwealth. So as he's getting ready to be commissioned into that, the United States gets involved in the war by 1917, early 1918. And then as he's trained and ready to go over to Europe to go fight, the war ends. So he never gets to go. So he has to go back home, goes back to Oxford, Mississippi. He's not in school. They tell him, go get a job. So he gets a little job. Then he goes a couple of places. He goes down to New Orleans for a little while. Then he winds up going a couple other places. And he decides that he wants to be a writer. He's been trying to write poetry. So he says the place to go now is Europe. That's where all those great writers, Scott Fitzgerald has already had success with a couple of books, including Great Gatsby. Hemingway has had success writing stories and novels. And they're all still over in Europe. So he decides he's going to go to Europe and soak in the atmosphere, try to find his calling, if you will. Your book in the little blurb before a barn burning, giving the background on, says that he went on a walking tour of Europe. There's a reason he went on a walking tour of Europe. He didn't have any money to pay for the trains. So if he wanted to get someplace, he had to walk. He doesn't stay there long. Finds his family come back home. And he is writing. He manages to make a couple of connections. And a publishing house, a small one, is willing to publish his poems. They do not sell well. They're called The Marble Faun, which is based off of the title actually is drawn from a couple of older works, but there was actually a collection of stories by Hawthorne called The Marble Faun. So there's a connection there with him too. The next couple of novels that he publishes, his first novel, the second novel do not sell well, but his third novel does better. And this is where, as he said, which you were supposed to listen to, it's when he gets to his third novel, he finds what he really needs to be doing with work. In both Barn Burning and in A Rose for Emily, you will have run across the name of Colonel Satoris. In Barn Burning, the main character is called Sari Snopes, and you find out that his full name is Colonel Satoris Snopes, named after the great Civil War general. In A Rose for Emily, there's reference about Colonel Satoris. I said generally Colonel. But Colonel Satoris is the mayor of the city at one point, who in 1894 says no more taxes for the Griersons. Miss Emily does not have to pay her taxes, and it remits them. that character is the lead character of the novel Sartorius when he's a younger man. These characters appear frequently. As I said, he uses Jefferson, which is a fictional version of Oxford, as his microcosm, a way of exploring the larger issues of the world. Characters come in and out of different stories, different novels. Sometimes they're older, sometimes they're younger. You'll see them in different stages. As such, you have to recognize that the presentations of them are going to be representative. Remember I said that allegory, everything becomes symbolic? Well, in A Rose for Emily, we have a reference to Colonel Sartorius and what he does. And then you have a reference about Judge Stevens. Stevens is another figure who appears at different times in different ways. One of the key aspects is that those two characters are reflections of that older attitude, that antebellum view of the world, the refusal to acknowledge that the world has changed around them, that Colonel Sartorius can do whatever he wants, remitting the taxes, saying that Miss Emily does not have to pay her taxes. As mayor, he doesn't quite have that authority, but in the antebellum South, the runner of his own plantation, his own world, he could do what he wanted. That adherence to the older tradition and the unwillingness to admit wrong or to change is emphasized with Judge Stevens when the woman comes to complain about the smell. He says, "What do you want me to do about it?" And he makes a comment. He utilizes a word. He uses the N-word. Because it's emphasized for you, and this is on page 780 in your text at the very top. This is, if you're looking for a paragraph or whatever, it may have a different edition of the book or whatever. It's right before paragraph 20. You have three lines of dialogue right above that, and it says, "A neighbor, a woman, complained to the mayor, Judge Stevens." He's the mayor now, so he's replaced Colonel Sartorius. "Complained to the mayor, Judge Stevens, 80 years old." Why do we need to know how old Judge Stevens is? Why is that something that should be included? When you put him at 80, is he of a more contemporary attitude?
No.
Where is he? The age of 80 places him where? A contemporary? Modern? Newer? Or a throwback? He's a throwback. He's an adherent to the old line. When the South was run by the plantation system, and an adherence to that. So the use of the N-word becomes part of that attitude, which is going to be replaced, altered. Later in the story, in fact, says, when the newer generation, this is on page, on page 783, this is paragraph 50, "Then the newer generation became the backbone and the spirit of the town." What he does in this story, Faulkner moves you from time to time to time, but he's not doing it chronologically or linearly. We start with Miss Emily Grierson dead, right? Well, as you go further into the story, next thing you know, she's alive. She's a young girl. Then she's older. Then you move back. Then you move forward. Then you move back. Then you move forward. Every time you move back, you don't move quite as far back as you did previously. So the story sort of skips at places, and then goes backwards. It's the whole idea of two steps forward, one step back as you go through it. So we start with her being dead. Well, you think, okay, that then the next part should be what happens right after that, and it's not. It's all the events that lead up to the people finally being able to go into the house again, being able to go into that town. We'll make sure this guy is working. As such, you have reference points and contrasts that are going to appear. As with the birthmark, where contrasts are very typical throughout the story, we have contrasts here as well. Sometimes it's contrast in the appearance of Emily Grierson. How does she look this time? And a number of comments are made about her physical features. The first reference in the story about her, it says that it's the time about the taxes. The new generation has taken over. They decide they're going to go try to collect the taxes. After this has been set up, they come in and they see her. And on page 779, this is our first image of her. A small, fat woman in black with a thin gold chain seen to her waist. Her skeleton was small and spare. She looked bloated, like a body lost, submerged in motionless water. And you go on from there. Then you move and you go down to a part where it says that she vanquished them just as she had vanquished her fathers 30 years before. So suddenly now we're going back 30 years. And when we see her again, this is the image that we have of her in paragraph 25. Next description about her, image of her, is that we had long thought of them as a tableau. About none of the young men being good enough. Miss Emily, a slender figure in white in the background. Our first image of her is a small, fat woman loaded in black. The next image where she is described physically, she's a slender figure in white. Contrast. One image to the next. Because that second image goes back 30 years before, right? Plus, before 30 years before, when she is a younger woman. Still part of that other system. Time has not changed yet. But as time does progress, as time does change, so too does she. And physically, she has changed, representing the changes that are inevitable, that have to take place. She doesn't pay her taxes, though. She holds on. And every year, it says later in the story, they send the notice, and every year it comes back. And they just, that's how they handle it. Nobody else goes to the house to demand taxes. They just send the notice, they get it back. Because as it says earlier in the story, it's actually the third paragraph. Alive, Miss Emily had been a tradition, a duty, and a care. So even though we move away from the past, even though we have progress, do things better and newer. And you folks, I've made some comments about research paper. I said, you know, research is much, has been simplified for you. Can access all you need with your laptops, your phones, your tablets, whatever you're going to use. You can actually access all the sources. So, you know, it used to be you had to go to the library and actually find the books. So progress, you know, which that makes everything wonderful now in the sense of trying to find research. Instead, you know, I've been researching, whenever I need to get some more background material, wherever I need it, I don't have to worry about going over to our library, trying to find a book. Check it out, bring it back, read through it. I can just call it up on the screen on my computer in my office. That's simplifying for us. It's progress. It's nice. But we still maintain traditions. Bless you. We still maintain traditions, do we not? We hold on to those. We say they're important to us. But if they're a holdover from an older era, if it is a relic, if you will, why do we hold on to it? That would be a question. You could try to answer. Why do we maintain traditions? Some of you don't know why we do it. And for instance, when you go to graduation ceremonies, right? You go to graduation ceremonies. They all seem to follow the same way. There's a tradition about them. Yes, sir.
We tend to maintain our sense of identity as culture.
That's part of it. It's where we have come from. And we're going to hold on to some of it, at least, because it helps us understand, as you said, sense of identity, who we are. And it creates that culture, if you will. The idea of preserving something that reminds us of where we have been and what we have been. We maintain those. But sometimes The reasoning for the tradition, the reasons why we keep that, are lost. The reasons become lost, just as in this story, it talks about Miss Emily dying, and she's going to be buried. It says that she had gone to join, this is the second paragraph, gone to join the representatives of those august names where they lay in a Cedar Bemue cemetery among the ranked and anonymous graves of Union Confederate soldiers who fell at the Battle of Jefferson. That she had gone to join the representatives of those august names. That she had once been an august name herself. That she's part of this. She's a Grierson, the last of the Griersons, it says. At one time, it talks about the high and mighty Griersons. And now she's gone to join not the revered elders of the community. August means reverence one or revered one. But the representatives of the august names. So that for much of it is simply a name on those tombstones. Exactly who the individual is, these people may not really understand or know that well. It's just a representative of the august names. When we get to poetry here in a few weeks, one of the poems by that I have asked you to look at. It's called Ulysses by Tennyson. And in that one, he takes the character of Odysseus after he's come back into the Odyssey, and he uses the Roman name, Ulysses, Tennyson does. And so Ulysses is looking out all the people who are there, who come to him, etc., and he makes a comment, I am become a name. He says, they know not me. For his people of Ithaca, Odysseus, Ulysses, feels they don't really know him anymore. He's just a name to them. This is what we have here. They're just names. We do that. And we don't always know who that is. For instance, this building, which quite often simply is called the academic building, that's how it's always labeled for you folks, right? It's always labeled A or AC. There's a name on this building. When you walk in, there's a painting. Mr. Gibbs. And of course, of course we know Mr. Gibbs. Right? You really do not. He was a member of the board of trustees for the college for a number of years, was chairman of the board. And they honored him. When they constructed this building, they named it after him. Because of all of his contributions to the school. You'll see that at different places. They want to honor the person. At University of Texas, where I went as an undergraduate, I actually lived in a dorm right across from Memorial Stadium. But it's not called Memorial Stadium anymore. It's called D.K. Royal Memorial Stadium. You go, okay. And D.K. Royal is? Anybody have a clue who D.K. Royal? Darryl Royal? No? He was a football coach at University of Texas for a long number of years. Won a couple of national championships. Retired after the 1976 season. And a few years, many years later, they decided to honor him because of his contributions to the school. They named the stadium partly after him. Because the stadium was already a memorial. That's why it's called Memorial Stadium. Technically, it's War Memorial Stadium. It's supposed to be named in honor of, in memory of, the soldiers who had attended the University of Texas and served this country. That's why it's called War Memorial Stadium. Everybody just called it Memorial Stadium. We honor people in that way, but eventually all they become to newer generations, as the book says, names, representatives of names. Everything is ephemeral, using a word from Birthmark, right? It all passes away quickly. Nothing lasts. Even the memories of these people will not last. At the end of the story, it talks about the old men who brushed off their Confederate uniforms and wore them and went to the funeral, trying to recall how they had danced with her. This is toward the end of the story. This is in section 5 of the story, in case you didn't see, the story is divided in different sections. 783 says the very old men, some of the brushed Confederate uniforms, were on the porch talking to Miss Emily as if she had been a contemporary of theirs, believing that they had danced with her and courted her, perhaps, confusing time with its mathematical progression, as the old do, to whom all the paths are not a diminishing road, but sit a huge meadow, which no winter ever quite touches, divided from them now by the narrow bondment of the most recent decade of years. That time becomes confused, not straightforward, not following its mathematical progression, one year to the next, to the next. Well, Faulkner, by writing the story as he does not follow mathematical progression of years. He shows us instead how our memory, how we view life, goes back and forth, back and forth. So he writes a story that way. His style fits his purpose. And as such, we go back and forth in the story, seeing one contrastive aspect after another. This conflict that exists because of these contrasts. Where you have early in the story, the first paragraph, it's one sentence. You have the attitude of men and women to the news that Miss Emily has died. And they're all going, this is the entire town attends the funeral, right? When Miss Emily Grierson died, our whole town went to her funeral. That means everybody did. And then it says, why the men did, why the women did. Contrast. The men, through a sort of respectful affection for a fallen monument. The women, mostly out of curiosity to see the inside of the house, which no one save an old manservant, the vine gardener cook, has seen in at least 10 years. Men went for one reason, that was a sense of appreciation for a fallen monument, affection for such, but women out of curiosity. Contrast in views and attitudes, how one gender viewed Miss Emily, how the other gender did. Is that contrast? And then you have that further contrast of generation, the further contrast of the change, how the South had been, represented by the last of the Griersons, and how it had become now, at the time the story is written, the changing from antebellum to postbellum. Antebellum means before the Civil War, postbellum after the war. Okay. When we say antebellum, postbellum in regard to the South, we mean Civil War. Okay. Look at the second paragraph, the description of the house. Again, as I've commented before, whenever you see a fairly bulky paragraph in a story, that's not that long. I mean, you're all going to go, this was longer than our other one. Not that much. Went from 778 to 784, so yes, we have 6 pages on this one. Sorry, you know, the other ones were 4 and 2, right, that we talked about. We had 6 pages. Look here. Now, the birthmark I know was longer. It was 12 pages. But when you look at this, look at any story, no story is going to be terribly long. Typically, I mean, some of them can go a little longer. But whenever you look at a story, especially one that's only 6 or 7 pages, and you see a fairly bulky paragraph, you probably should pay attention to those. Why write that much in this space? The writer obviously has something he wants to get across there. So you look at this, and we see that in that part, we have the description of the house. It comes early. We have the setting established for us. Remember when we talked about Hills Like White Elephants? And we have the opening paragraph. Again, fairly bulky compared to the rest of it, since it's mostly dialogue. But you have that, you know, several lines of prose, and it's focused on the setting, is it not? It's focused on the setting. Well, the second paragraph, we have the setting. He goes into detail about the house and about the town itself and the cemetery where she's going to wind up. But we have the details about the house. And notice how it's phrased, because that shows us this contrast of one time to the next. So the house had once been white, and that it was seen on what had once been the most select street in the town. That had once been is repeated, and it emphasizes for us what had been, what used to be, as opposed to what is now. It had once been white, which tells you not white anymore, right? And that this street upon which this house resides had once been the most select street. Actually, it says our most select street. It's not the most select street anymore, is it? Rather, this entire neighborhood, if you will, has altered, has changed. Conditions are different because the time is different. It is a changed world. And the conditions are such that it has gone from residential to commercial, signifying a change of focus where you have the larger homes and the agrarian attitude of the South. Everything was in around agriculture. Not anymore. It now becomes commercial. These are cotton gins and gas stations. You have a changing world where you have a commercial enterprise taking over what had once been a home. It says that they had encroached and obliterated. That's how the phrasing is in the story there. It says that the garages and cotton gins had encroached and obliterated even the august names of that neighborhood. Only Miss Emily's house was left, lifting its stubborn and coquettish decay above the cotton wagons and the gasoline pumps. Garages, cotton gins, working areas. This is not the manicured lawns and the large pillared houses anymore. The ones with the colonnades. No. Only Miss Emily's house is left. And it's decay. Talks about its coquettish decay. A little flirtatious. Oh, we can still think about the past a little bit there. But it's decaying. It is called an eyesore among eyesores. So that the gins and the garages, which are not going to be attractive, really. This house stands out even among those. It looks in worse condition than even those do. It's an eyesore among eyesores. Times have changed. This house at once was a magnificent structure is no more. Its status, if you will, has altered. Time has changed. Faulkner's drawing the point that time changes all of this. The South changes. When Colonel Satoris, which is the next part you get into, about the taxes. Because you get into that in the third paragraph, where it says that Colonel Satoris, the mayor, he who followed you, that no Negro woman should appear on the streets without an apron, remitted her taxes. Dispensation date for the death of her father on into perpetuity. This idea of, again, as I said previously, that Colonel Satoris takes on the role of absolute control. That's when he feels he can issue any edict he wants. Because he's that holdover. The last vestige, if you will, of the old South. He is Colonel Satoris. He's known as Colonel Satoris. Well, he's a colonel in the Confederate Army, is what he is. Well, that's gone. There is no Confederacy, but he's still known as Colonel Satoris. Good for all the different stories. He's still known as Colonel Satoris. An aspect of respect, but also a carryover, a relic. His title is a relic. He feels he can issue any order he wants, whether demanding that any Negro woman has to appear with an apron. They're not all going to be cooks or servants in that way as they used to be. And he feels he can remit the taxes into perpetuity, so he'll never have to pay them again. That's a holdover. Because the newer generation comes along, that's what we have right after that. It says, only a man of Colonel Satoris' generation thought could have invented it. Well, he comes up with a story about why that her father loaned the town money and they were going to pay it off this way. Then he makes a contrast of attitude. Sorry, ladies, it's a little gender bias that only a woman would have believed it, he said. Somewhat limited. But then you have, right after that, you have again, we move forward. We've been at one time she's dead. We move back in time to when she's alive. And the taxes are removed right after her father's died. And then we jump forward to the, as it says, when the next generation, with its more modern ideas, became mayors and aldermen. Notice it's plural, mayors and aldermen. It's not just this one time, it's going to be extended on through. But it's the next generation. They're the ones who decide to try to get the money from her. Try to demand she pay her taxes. So they go to see her, and that's our first introduction to Miss Emily, as I said earlier. Our first image of her, a small, fat woman in black. And of course, she routs them. And they come into the house, which is covered in dust. Everything seems to be old. Everything is tarnished. Focus upon the tarnished images that we see there. It's that relic. And of course, they do not receive the money. She tells Tobe or Toby, since you'll hear it pronounced both ways, to please show these gentlemen out. And off they go. And Faulkner changes time again. She riled them as she had riled them 30 years before. So you have, she's dead. We move back, then we move forward, not to the point where she's dead, but then we move back again. 30 years. Not long after her father had died, it says. You can constantly move back and forth that way. So we have this constant juxtapositioning of time periods. The constant contrast of what was, what is. And then we keep moving that way. All the way throughout the story. It's this constant juxtaposing of one image after the other. So you can see the contrast. When Miss Emily takes up with Homer Baron, the northerner who has come to help with the construction of streets, they're going to pave the sidewalks. Well, we clearly have moved forward, have we not? Paving sidewalks, having streets. Newer time. And so the northerner comes in. Well, contrast right there, right? A good southern woman taking up with a Yankee. That's why all the people in town started, all the women started pitying her. They could say, poor Emily, we could pity her because she's having to take up with a Yankee. And then we move back again. You move back. You constantly go in one place to the next. It says, we were glad Miss Emily would have had an interest because all the ladies said, of course, the Grierson would not think seriously of a northerner, a day laborer. But others, older people, said that even grief could not cause a real lady to forget noblesse oblige. They just said, poor Emily, her kinfolk should come for her, to her. So you have this back and forth, and you have this idea about, like when she bought the rat poison, the arsenic. That was over a year after they began to say, poor Emily. So we move to when she gets the poison, and then you jump back again. You know, one after the other. And of course, what happens is that when you see sections, and then you move forward, and then you move back, you have to remember the detail of what you saw when you move forward and back, because they're going to come into play. They're going to help indicate something for us. In the birthmark, I told you that seeing the flower that sprouted immediately and then withered and died immediately serves as foreshadowing of what we may really anticipate will happen with Georgiana once the potion is given to her. Well, we have foreshadowing in this story as well. Because prior to Homer Baron being introduced, you have the reference where the woman went to Judge Stevens, now 80 years old. The idea about Judge Stevens being the carryover from the previous generation, while we have to have his age. Otherwise, you don't need his age. You just said old Judge Stevens. That'd be fine. No, we have 80 years old to let you know how far back we go. That woman comes and complains about the smell. And Judge Stevens' response when he receives complaints from others says, "Will you accuse a lady to her face of smelling bad?" Because, of course, gentlemen, you do not get to say that. That's old code, right? The old code. How one treats a lady. Notice the use of the terminology. A lady. Not a woman, but a lady. And as such, we have that maintenance of the chivalric South. You cannot tell a lady she smells bad. Ladies. Guys, ladies, women do not sweat. They listen. That's it, right, ladies? You listen. I swear. But ladies. So, of course, what they do, several men go one evening and spread lime around the house. They smell around, trying to figure where the smell seems to be coming most strongly. Go into the cellar and put lime around, because lime will absorb the smell. That's what baking soda basically is, okay? The lime derivative. So you put it in to absorb the smells in your refrigerator. That's what they did. They sprinkled lime all the way around the house to try to absorb the smell. Well, that is forward a bit. Then we go back to when her father dies and how she refuses to acknowledge her father is dead. The women show up as, you know, Southern tradition, right? Somebody has passed away, ladies of the community, take meals. All right? Go to the... Right? They show up at the house with potluck. You know, here we go. We brought you something to eat. We brought you this dinner. And when they show up at the house, Emily greets them, tells them, she doesn't admit them, she keeps them on the porch, and says, her father is not dead. So, okay. They go and tell the minister. They go and try to convince her. Then they have to go get the other people involved. And eventually, after 3 days, it says, she broke down. And they buried the body quickly. Because it's been 4 or 5 days since he passed away. She refuses to admit. She's holding on to the traditions. She's holding on to the past. She holds on to what she says she knows. Colonel Satoris told me I have no taxes in Jefferson. And she holds on to it and refuses to let it go. Her father is the one she has in her life and she's not letting him go. Well, notice that story about the father actually came before the story about the lime, but in the story, the details about the lime, those details are presented before you get to the issue about the father, right? So you've gone forward in time, now you move back. Then you jump ahead again. Not quite as far as the line this time, but we pick up there. And then we move forward a little bit because she's dating Homer Baron. Then we jump forward a little bit where she goes and gets poisoned. Then we move back a little bit where she's still dating Homer Baron. And then Homer Baron is gone. And so as you move into that, it says that, you know, the poison, so in section 4, says she will kill herself. When she had first begun to be seen with Homer Baron, we had said she will marry him. So now, you know, she's got the poison, and then when you start section 4, you pick up right there, and then you move back again. When she had first begun seeing Homer Baron. Well, we already had that mentioned to us in section 3, right? So you move back again. You've gone forward, now you move back. Not quite as far back. So they're talking about the relationship with Homer Baron. Says that they would drive through the town with the buggy that has already been mentioned for us. Says that the ladies forced the Baptist minister, as Emily's people were Episcopalian, to call upon her. He would never divulge what happened during the interview, but he refused to go back again. The next Sunday, they again drove about the streets. Following in the minister's wife, wrote to Miss Emily's relations in Alabama. So now we're moving back by her relations. Then we move forward. She has gone and bought a man's toilet set in silver with HB initials on it. Now, toilet set means a hairbrush, a comb, a mirror, probably, you know, nail clippers of some sort. You know, it's not the toilet set that you think, oh, you know, that stuff that you get, you know, the rug and all that stuff you put around your commode. No, the toilet set would be hairbrushes and all that. Yes, sir?
It's because in toilet was actually not originally used to describe the toilet.
That's right. It was not. It was, instead, it was the actual preparation. To perform your toilet meant that you went in and fixed your hair, your nails, do all that sort of stuff. But since we started doing it in and around the bathroom, which is where the commodes wound up being, the water tanks, as they originally were called, were installed, that word gets associated with that now. So she buys this hairbrush and all these nice niceties. What's it called, that one? For clearly Homer Behrings, because they're initialed in silver. They're in silver and they're initialed. She takes those and she goes and buys a man's suit of clothes and a nightshirt. Now that tells you something very seriously, right there. She's buying a nightshirt. You know, a lady buying a nightshirt for a man, that really seems to indicate something. And the people leap on that because notice what they say. They are married. Because, of course, a lady would not buy a nightshirt for anybody she is not married to. That's not what you refuse to not do that. Because a lady would not be in any way having an intimate relation with somebody who is not her husband. Not going to happen for later. That's why they're needing to gossip about who maybe she is. Emily Grierson sleeping around? Oh my gosh. They could. But except, you know, that's only the cuckold sign is for to be put above the head of a man who's married and his wife is sleeping around. So neither one of them are married, so it really didn't apply. But the other day, some of these interviews that they were doing for players, Super Bowl and everything. Two of the players, one of the players did that to one of the other ones. And I went, okay, does he really know why he just did it? He doesn't. He just thought, ooh, bunny ears. That's not what it means. In case you're wondering, this is something I've told my students before. Remember when you were younger? Some of you have heard this story before, sorry. When you were younger, you know, elementary school, having your class pictures taken, do you remember putting that above the head of somebody and everybody laughing and thinking it's funny? That's called the sign of the cuckold, or putting the horns on someone. Which means that the person who has that put behind his head, that person's wife, it's limited to males, supposedly. That person's wife has cheated on him. She's sleeping around on him. He doesn't know. It's called the sign of the cuckold. Children saw that and noticed that, well, the adults laughed every time they were doing it. So the children started doing it, laughing too, not knowing the real reason. And Ethan, this actually ties in. We maintain something without really knowing the true meaning. Ties into the story. The traditions are maintained. Why? Because we've always done it that way. Jefferson, alderman, mayor, they send the notice for the taxes to Miss Emily, and she sends it back. And they wait for the next year, they do it again. Why? That's the way we've always done it. We don't understand the true meaning. As the people aren't quite sure of the true meaning of certain actions that are taken. When she buys the poison, they pity her and say she will kill herself. Well, I already told you, Miss Emily Grierson is a person who holds on to what she knows. She holds on to what she has and does not relinquish it easily. Took them 3 days to get her father's body out of the house. And only because she broke down. Well, this time she's not going to break down. Homer Behrings, again, is mentioned for us about what he's like. The Because they'll say she'll persuade him to marry because he had remarked that he was not a marrying man, but they still are seen. So her relatives show up, and then we sat back and watched, nothing happened. We learned that she bought these, so we were not surprised when Homer Barron was gone because the relatives were there. We were a little disappointed there was not a public blowing off, but we believe that he'd gone on to prepare for Miss Emily's coming or to give her a chance to get rid of the cousins. After another week, they departed, and as we had expected, within 3 days, Homer Barron was back in town. A neighbor saw the Negro man and met him at the kitchen door at dusk one evening. And that was the last we saw of Homer Barron. Notice you move back and forth, back and forth. We're now back to a time before the line is needed. But we're after the time of the poison being purchased. And so, when we next saw Miss Emily, so let me jump forward again. She had grown fat. Now, earlier, remember, she was that slender figure in white. Last time you had any sort of description about her, slender figure in white. Being seen driving up and down. She was a figure who had had long hair at one time, but when they seen her after her father's death, she'd cut it short and looked like a girl, a young girl. Those were images of the last time any physical details were given for us. Her going out with Homer Barron where she's dressed nicely, so you don't gain this impression. She was 30 now, it says. 31. And the next time they see her, she had grown fat. And her hair was turning gray. During the next few years, it grew grayer and grayer until it attained an even pepper and salt iron gray when it ceased turning. Up to the day of her death, at 74, it was still that vigorous iron gray, like the hair of an active man. The hair turns iron gray. I can appreciate that. Well, it's not iron gray, it's just sort of white now, but it turns that way. And so suddenly we have details. Time is inevitable. But, as I said, once she gets something set, she holds on to it. Her hair quits turning after a while. It holds on to that iron gray color. And as such, what we wind up with is, of course, the details will emerge. They find out she's dead. They come into the house. Toby opens the door, lets them in, and walks out the back. They're seen again, so they go through the house. And there's one room upstairs they know that's locked. They have to break down the door. When they break down the door, we see what Emily has held on to because she refuses to acknowledge time passes. Just as the South clings to the old image sometimes and won't acknowledge it. Progress is inevitable. A newer generation comes along and things change. It's that contrast of values and attitudes. Just as we saw with the birth mark, contrast of attitudes. They walk in. Dusting to fill everywhere. Says that. This is page 784. Upon the dressing table, upon the delicate array of crystal, and the man's toilet things, backed with tarnished silver, silver so tarnished that the monogram was obscured, among them lay a collar and tie, as if they had just been removed, which lifted, left upon the surface a pale crescent in the dust. So they've been there for a while. Upon a chair hung the suit, carefully folded. Beneath it, the two new shoes and the discarded socks. The man himself lay in the bed. For a long while, we just stood there, looking down at the profound and fleshless grin. The body had apparently once lain in the attitude of an embrace. But now the long sleep that outlasts love, that conquers even the grimace of love, had cuckolded it. There's our word, cuckold. What was left of him, rotted beneath what was left of the nightshirt, had become inextricable from the bed in which he lay, and upon him and upon the pillow beside him lay that even coating of the patient and biting dust. Now you know why you didn't see Homer Barron anymore. She poisons him. Places him in the bed. Now, did she poison him while he was in the bed, or did she poison him and put him in the bed with help? You do not know. You just know he's there. But the body has appeared to lay in an embrace. I mean, at some point, somebody was holding. And then you have the last part of it, where one of them leans forward. We notice in the second pillow was of the patient and body dusting. We notice in the second pillow was the indentation of a head. One of us lifted something from it, and leaning forward, that faint and invisible dust dry and acrid in the nostrils, we saw a long strand of iron gray hair. Now remember, when she and Homer Barron went out driving, her hair was black. It didn't start turning for years afterwards, until it gradually reached that iron gray. So somebody had lain recently on that bed, probably embracing Homer Barron. What was left of it? Told you, sometimes we refuse to let go. Homer is certain he can perfect his wife, but the grip on mortality is strong. When that grip is released, relinquished, if you want to be perfect, it's not going to work. Emily wouldn't let go. She held on to it. For your first essay, the topic is up at Blackboard. You can download it. For the class here in front, I'll be giving copies to everybody. Okay. We'll pass everybody that way. Eight there. Nine. And we're in. Most of you are going, oh my gosh, you gave us a two-page topic. No, most of it are the explanations of what I expect you to do. The actual topics are on the back where you'll see numbers 1 and 2. When you write an essay, you are expected to follow certain formatting, certain details. I try to specify as much as I can in here what I need you to do. Literary analysis means that you're going to evaluate a work of literature. In this case, I wind up changing that. You can do a story, or actually you have a chance to do two stories if you want to do a comparison. You're going to focus on specific areas, examine different elements, so that the writer, that means you, will engage in a process to offer a deeper appreciation and understanding of that literary work or works. I have put in there, you're not engaging your audience in a conversation, but arguing your understanding with reason and developed explanation. Do not treat this as a conversation. Did you not get one?
Yeah, I got a lot of questions.
Not until like end of week 5, February 17th or 18th, something like that. You have a couple weeks. Hold on, guys. Not yet. That means, ladies and gentlemen, you will not start a sentence with well, followed by a comma.
Well,
the way this is. No, that's conversational. You're not engaged in a conversation. You will not utilize contractions. Those do not belong in formal writing. I mentioned specifically here, there are no I's and U's to be used. I should have put we's. No we's either. Do not need that. Make your points. When you want to say, I think that Hawthorne offers a number of contrasts, say that. Hawthorne offers a number of contrasts. I don't even know that I think that. If you're not doing the thinking, somebody else is going to get credit for the paper. So, none of that. No I's, no U's. I should put no we's. Do not do that. That will impact tremendously. You'll see that puts certain words in bold because those are the elements, as I say here, you will need to have these elements in your essay. A thesis, supportive paragraphs, evidence, and analytical discussion. That's what you're asked to do. No summaries. You'll see that also at the bottom of the first page. Says a summary is not an analysis. You will not summarize the story. Do not retell the story to me. I've read all of these. Tells you about content and format, MLA format, which means, folks, double space. When you do any assignment for me, even a daily assignment, I expect MLA format. I expect complete sentences. So, double space your responses on the daily review. Marked it for most of you really didn't take off for that, but that will be impactful here. Because if you do not follow MLA format, go back and look at the rubric, you'll see how far over to the left you get scored. When you refer to the story or stories you're choosing to analyze, present tense. Present tense verbs. On the back, it'll talk to you about plagiarism. Do not do that. And then you'll have your choice of topics. One asks you to choose one story, one central feature of the story. The other one gives you the option to do one feature, but compare how two different stories utilize it. To what extent? We'll talk further about that on Tuesday, and I will see you then.